with them, which is breaking a command, not one of the Big Ten, but one of the don't eat with non-Jews. You see, in that culture, if you ate with someone, you were saying you were an equal to them. You were equal. It's kind of an interesting thing because we might eat with someone we don't think is necessarily our equal, or we don't think about that anymore. You know? But in those days, if you broke bread with someone, they were your equals. And so that's why the Pharisees had such a hard time with Jesus eating with sinners, forgetting that they also were sinners, because according to the law, the Pharisees were keeping the law, so they were not sinning. But tax collectors and prostitutes and people that didn't quite meet their idea of how you were supposed to live your life, they were excluded. And Jesus would go and eat with them. I've heard it said, and I think it's wise, when you draw a line on the sand and say, these people are not welcome, Jesus says, oh, watch this, and he steps over the line and joins those we have chosen not to welcome. Be careful about that, because God's vision is that all are of equal value. John 3:16 says that Jesus died for the whole planet. Not just the Jews, not just the in crowd, not just those that we deem acceptable or unacceptable. Everybody. We're all in this together. And then you get this vision in the book of Revelation about a new Jerusalem, because the old things have passed away. And if you notice, and this is important when you hear all this rapture from that goes around. It says very clearly, God comes down. We don't go up. God comes down to us and joins us. He lives among us. And that there will be no more sorrow. There will be no more death. There will be no more pain. He will wipe away every tear. And that's a promise from God. And we can hold tight to that promise in the midst of sorrow. But we can also hold tight to that promise in the midst of joy. Because if God is making all things new where there is no pain, can you imagine how much more our joy will be increased? And that's the promise of the New Jerusalem. And all people will be there. You know, the old joke is that when you get to heaven, you're going to be amazed by who's there. I'm thinking, I'll be amazed I'm there. You know, I know my inventory. I know where I've been and what I think and stuff like that. But I also know that I am a forgiven child of God. Not because I'm so wonderful, but because Jesus died on that cross. And he died for me, but he died for each and every one of you. And he died for everybody outside this building, and everybody outside this community, and everybody outside this country, everybody outside this continent, for God so loved the world, the entire planet. The Greek word in the original text was cosmos. It was all of the universe. For God so loved the universe. And when we decide that these people are in and these people are out, or we don't like this way of thinking, or we don't like the way these people pray to God, we diminish God's vision. We diminish God's love for his creation. After everything he created, he pronounced it good. But it wasn't the word good, which is what we translated. It was the Hebrew word tov, T-O-V. And it means complete. It means that everything is as it should be. It is righteous. It is as God created it. And he created humanity to be in companionship with one another. And then Jesus gave that last command. You know, the gospel starts with when he had departed. Who had departed? Judas had departed. Judas Iscariot had departed to go set up the ambush at the Garden of Gethsemane. Those people. Those people have been praying to the God of Abraham for centuries. We pray to the God of Abraham and have for centuries. And our Jewish brothers and sisters pray to the God of Abraham and have done that for centuries. I'm thinking, man, if we're all praying to the same God, it isn't God that's separating us. Who is? Yeah, we are. We are. And we're caught up in this, my tribe's better than your tribe kind of mentality, and God's like, oy. I have said this before, that when they talk about Jesus went up to the mountainside to pray, I'll tell you right now, he went up and he said to God, oy, those people you've given me. And then he took a nap. Trust me on this, he took a nap. And then he prayed. Or somewhere in that way. But we have been called to love one another, and not just that hallmark sentimental love, but to the wall, to the cross, to our death love. Standing up for someone, Martin Luther gave the best explanation of the not bearing false witness. He said, and I'm going to paraphrase it for today's world, stand up for your neighbor. Think the best. Give the best motives to your neighbor. If they're doing something you don't quite understand, don't assume it's something nefarious, but rather that it is something good, and that they have their reasons. That's part of loving one another. When you have a complaint with someone, instead of going on Facebook, putting all these vague, oh, when somebody just goes against me, I'm like, stop! Go to that person, that's what Jesus said, and say to them, this has hurt me, this is why. How do we reconcile? How do we reconcile? Jesus in the Sermon on the Mount said it really clear. If you don't forgive somebody, Father in heaven won't forgive you. Those are kind of scary words, I think. So keep short accounts. And love one another. You don't understand somebody's way of living, doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. God loves that. If you don't understand why somebody is doing something that you don't do, doesn't matter. And if they don't understand what you're doing, doesn't matter. We are called to love one another. It's foundational. We sing that old song, they will know we are Christians by our love. That's a lie today, isn't it? Christianity has been swung through the mud in this country because words out of preachers are words of hate and division. Don't be like that. Don't be like that. Tell them, no, God loves the whole planet and God loves them too. One of the hardest things about being a Christian is that God loves your enemies as much as God loves you. So we're called to be kind to one another, to uphold one another, to pray for one another, to include one another. Trust that God knows what God is doing. Trust that. Because that's the reality. When I hear people say, oh, this will never work, I'm thinking, well, how small is your God? Our God is the creator of the universe. And our God loves each and every one of us here in this building, and each and every one of our St. John people that have chosen not to be here today, for various reasons. More cookies for us. And God has chosen to bless Carroll. God loves everybody in every pew in this city this morning, but he also loves equally everyone who is not in a pew this morning. He loves those who pray like this. He loves those who pray with beads. He loves those who get on their knees and put their face to the ground in reverence to a holy and righteous God. He loves those who have concept of what Zen would be like. created in God's image. We are all created with this God spark that makes us yearn for the holy, makes us yearn for the right, makes us yearn for love. God is life, and God is love, and God is holy. And we have all that today, this moment, forever. You are all beloved. You have all been died for. And God raised Jesus from death so that when we are mourning and the tears flow and there's not even Kleenexes in the house, we have to go to